welcome everybody to the Open Group Conference at San Francisco. It is an amazing time to be meeting and talking. What I plan to do today, which is Internet of Things and security. Lots of things have happened in recent time that have made us sit and worry and see that we have to play a much active role. And therefore, we all at Open Group have a big role to play in ensuring that the Internet of Things brings a secure life rather than a one which is hijacked by ThinkBots. So as I go through this agenda, I will talk about the state of Internet of Things, where it is today, what we have on the horizon, what does a hijacked IoT look like, and how do we prevent those hijackings. So there are three words I want to lay out there, and I want to, as I talk about it, we will be going through three mental states. The first is, why the hijackings? Why is it that these vulnerabilities, why do we get hijacked? Why do the Internet of Things get hijacked? The second is, what? What happens when there is a hijacking? And the third part of the discussion would be, how do we prevent it? So let us talk about it without much ado. So we know that Internet of Things is pervasive. It's pervasive in all environments, which is energy, transportation, health, security. We don't even have to go through those in great detail because you all have been part of the innovations that have made it possible. So here are the group of the inventors that actually did that. So let us talk about it. We have a plethora of remotely connected devices. And why is it? Because we have the ability to remotely control them. So we are just lazy. We can control it through remote. Why should we not do it? So every area, when the technology offered us the ability to remotely control it and do various things that we need to do, we jumped at that opportunity. IDC predicts that there will be 200 billion things by 2020. And it's everywhere. Appliances, whether it's a microwave or a toaster, washing machine, it is in control. Control is a big thing. Because when you talk about control, you're talking about thermostats and meters, which means that the area that is covered by IoT is much bigger than just a household appliance. And it gets bigger from there. Even security has lot of IoT, Internet of Things within them. Example, baby monitors, burglar alarms, security, cameras, door locks. And then you take it a step further, even about human life. Whether it is a medical machinery, medical device, or wearable devices, they all have Internet of Things within them. And then you talk about the infrastructure, which is taking not one, but the whole city, or a bridge, which impacts everybody who crosses that bridge. So we have in energy some examples. We know that home and building energy management uses a lot of remotely connected devices. It learns, it adapts, and it controls how energy is used. And that helps us reduce the carbon footprint. Therefore, this is very pervasive. To talk recently, Nest Labs has been acquired by Google, and they built thermostats and programmable smoke detectors. Knowing Google, we know this is just the starting point. They will use this technology to replicate across all other verticals. So let's talk about IoT in transportation. It is everywhere. Even the containers that we ship contain remotely controlled devices upon them. Toyota has advanced IT systems that can help driver avoid the accidents. And then also there are dynamic electro-controlled devices. So in health, there are a lot of ways by which they are being used. And since I am Chief Technologist of Innovation of Health and Life Sciences, I would pay a little more attention on this slide. I have the right to do so. And it is heart rate monitoring. Our heart rate is monitored, blood oxygen and respiratory rate can be monitored, which means a big thing, a big value in our life. Elderly care managed. Lungs, kidney can be monitored from remote, brain scan imaging, as well as elderly activity. So these are some of the examples in health. Security is another area we mentioned. Just to touch on the few things, we can control children's access to different devices, or we can use phone to make a keyless entry, or lock it up if we left it unlocked. So that's kind of the start. First, what I talked about was where are we? So remember, there are three things I want to talk about: the hijacking here, when IoT things are hijacked. Why does it happen? What happens when a hijacking occurs, and how do we prevent it? So we talked about the things that were not within our body, and now I want to take that vulnerability to the next level by talking about the devices that are within our body or that impact us in a much more intimate, invasive fashion. So contact lenses by Google, for example, when diabetics have difficulty managing blood sugar, they cannot live as long as other people. And how do they control blood sugar? By taking the blood test. But how often can a diabetic take blood test? How often can the finger be pricked? Once an hour, or maybe once in 2 hours? That's just not good enough. So Google contact lenses do that, measuring the tear once every second. That's as good as our normal pancreas does. This is amazing. And not only that, it gives you early warning that something's gone wrong, above the range, below the range. So even if you're sleeping, you don't have to fall into coma because your blood sugar are too high or too low. And how does it do that? It takes two layers of soft contact lens material, and within that, it puts two miniature things. One is a glucose sensor, and the other one is a tiny wireless chip. And the beauty is the antenna that is used is thinner than a human ear. And the one thing that I really like about it, you have to think, how does it get its power? And it gets its power from the radio frequency in the environment, or the other devices outside the body that it is interacting with. So it's really cool, and you have to see how much is at stake here as we talk about security. Firefighters is another segment, a very noble profession where people save lives, and they jump into a burning building to save others. But one problem that they face is once they are in a building, they lose, inside the smoke, they lose sense of direction. They lose sense of how to find their way back. Many firefighters lose their life because they don't know how to get out of a burning building after they just saved somebody. And this came from Sweden, KTH, Royal Institute of Technology. And what does it do? It has smart shoes. What does it do with the smart shoes? It has GPS tracking within the shoes, and they can save lives of firefighters. And what does it do? It uses a digital positioning system as well as advanced sensors. And it also has accelerometer and gyroscope, which is, and a processor. So it's like a computer, right? It's like a whole computer that's in the heel of their feet. And the last bullet, I think, is the most important one. It can, and this is especially for people who risk their life for others, it can withstand shock. It can withstand very extremely high temperature. And it works 25 meters below the ground. So amazing. The other thing is motor impaired people. That's another segment of society that we want technology to help. Because motor impaired people cannot move in the environment just like a normal human being does. So what is the difference between a normal human being and somebody who has lost his limb or the function or has got his limbs cut off? The brain tries, how do we move things around us? The brain sends those signals and our bodies react and follow those commands and act. In case of somebody who is lost that limb, those brain signals are still the same, and that's the beauty. They generate exactly the same brain signal. So if we can put a bionic chip to make the bridge between the external environment and the brain, they are as good as new. And that's exciting, very exciting. So BrainGate has a bionic chip. And And what does it do? It interprets and translates those signals and converts them into movement. And it analyzes the brain's signal. And a computer outside is used as a gateway to transmit and take further action on those brain signals. You can convert, somebody can use the brain. Basically, a thought is converted to action. And as a result, we can move the wheelchair, we can move, work on the computer, and even do other activities like a normal person. One other problem that some section of humanity faces is fertilization. Fertilization occurs when a sperm reaches an egg sac. Due to many problems, sometimes that's just not easy to do. And therefore, we need help in fertilization so that sperm can reach the egg cell within our body. Dresden Institute of Integrative Nanosciences, Germany, have created a sperm bot. Sperm bot is a robot which is on a sperm. How does it work? A sperm bot takes live sperm cells and basically hijacks that sperm cell and gets hijacks the sperm cell, creates a boundary or a wall around it that you see, and externally we can use a magnetic field to change the direction of the sperm, and also the speed is controlled by changing the temperature. So that helps the sperm bot reach the egg. After the sperm bot reaches the egg, then what happens? It then releases magnetically the sperm so that the fertilization can take place. That's amazing. Combination of biology and technology to do these things, it's just amazing. Bacteria bots can help detect cancer. And so Cheonam National University of South Korea has created that. How do they? Cancer can be treated today, but the chemotherapy, if cancer doesn't kill you, chemotherapy will. Because chemotherapy is not localized, it affects all parts of the body. It treats the whole body as if it is cancer. The reality is, tumor is only on a few cells. So how is that fixed? It takes a Salmonella is a bacteria. It takes a non-toxic bacteria and then does some genetic modifications so that what we get is attracted to the cancer cell. And that is what is used in a bacteria bot. It is a genetically modified non-toxic Salmonella, and that is let go inside the body and it attacks the cancer by going straight towards the tumor cell. And how does it go? Who pushes it? Flagella. And that's a beauty, because flagella is the body's own internal biological engine. So by using that, it's like take a ride on the flagella and kill the cancer. There is yet another bio walk, they call it. They walk on their own. It is used to do drug screening or to do chemical analysis or to go for a very special toxin and then kill it in its own environment. University of Illinois created these miniature biobots. Why are they called bio? Because they are created by hydrogel as well as a heart cell. Those two are put together. So when they have to be put in the body, they are put together by a 3D printer. And the 3D printer uses the extrusion mechanism to create the biobot, which is sent within the body and is programmed chemically to go for a special toxin. So these are the scenarios where more and more amazing things are happening within Internet of Things, where the devices that are being controlled are within our body. Microbots is another one, and they deliver drugs. They are as small as a human cell. Can you imagine? And what you see is a big bottle. They are 100 micron long and 40 micron wide. How do they work? It's a cage-like device. And then these are microbots that are injected into your body. So you can imagine if the needle can inject thousands of microbots within your body, how small would they be? And what are they used for? Various purposes. They can deliver drug to local things for which you don't want the whole body to consume that drug. Uh, this is a non-medical thing that is very exciting, and that is we have wireless power. How is wireless power used in a different way? We've had wireless power for a while, but the big thing, the big breakthrough that has now happened is you can now take a stationary device and wirelessly power a moving device. That is a breakthrough, electromagnetically. And this means that cars, electric cars that are on highways, will be automatically fueled by the highways themselves. There are highway stations. You just drive through the highway as if nothing is happening. The highway station have the transmitter coils. The mobile receiver is in the car. And when the car goes through, the receiver couples with the transmitter and energy is transferred. And after that, car goes out of range, the fueling stops. I really like that. I don't like to put gas in my car. So I was talking about, you know, how our life is filled with Internet of Things. Let's talk about why. Why do they get hijacked? What makes them so vulnerable? There are, earlier, we used to have embedded system. They were little small processor inside some small appliance which is inside your house, and it is controlled by the owner. Nobody sees it, nobody has any need to do any mischief with it. Now, these smart things are full-fledged computers. And they have everything, they are also on the public internet. And hackers can connect them and control them, just like they control other computers. And that is the crux of the problem. Because we love them because of everything they bring to us, and that itself is the problem. That is why security is imperative in Internet of Things. So what are the points of vulnerabilities? We talked about the fact that smart devices are full-fledged computers. They have processors, sensors, and computer identifiable tags. They all generally come with factory default passwords, and they are never changed. They are hardwired, they never change. They don't run anti-spam or antivirus software, and they don't receive regular updates. Because of these reasons, we have so many points of vulnerability, and that is the part of when asked, why does it happen? It happens because our devices are vulnerable. Therefore, we need standards. So let's go further and look into it. This is where you know that when we had problems with our computers, we would call them. The hackers would take control of them, use them like a robots, army of robots, and do all kind of problems. But now, things have changed. Now, these are not computers, they are things that are getting attacked. So what happens? It poses, Internet of Things poses a big threat because they are very easy to hijack, they are very easy to penetrate. And they are called botnets. And these hijacked things can be controlled to do all kind of bad things, malicious things, like they can send spam, they can send a lot of traffic to create a denial of service attack. And what do we call those things that are hijacked? We call them think bots, because they have become robots, they become an army of robots. Think bot is the big thing that we have to make sure our things don't turn into. So let's talk about some recent attacks that have happened on embedded systems, things that earlier were unthinkable. One thing I want to point out here is we don't think about router as a smart device, but it is. It is a smart device and it has all the vulnerabilities, because who runs an anti-spam software on routers? So, and therefore, router is as bad as our own fridge and TV. The DNS changer was a recent attack. And what does it? What did it do? It brought down a multitude, millions of DSL routers in Brazil. And it was a home router malware. It was a malware that went and attacked the router in the house. And there was another one. It was called Linux Talos. And it was discovered by Symantec. And they compromised, targeted only the embedded systems. There was another one called Karma Botnet, which compromised almost 500,000 devices. These are happening like recently, talking about. Then one big thing was I don't know how many of us used TrendNet security cameras. They were hijacked. And these are the videos of private homes. They were put on the internet. And so this was the first time TrendNet was in hot water, of course, right? And then they had to pay up big money. This was, I think, the first case where they actually took action. So now they're beginning to think about security standards, laws, regulations. The most recent one, ThingBot, was reported by Proofnet. That was just this month, and last month in January, and it attacked connected devices. So let's look into what this Proofpoint ThingBot looks like. So basically, it's an army of infected devices. And what do? They're controlled, it may be your phone, it may be your fridge, it may be your, but somebody outside is controlling it and making it do awful things. And what are those things? They did actually 750,000 phishing and spam. And this came from 100,000 smart appliances. And what was the reason? Because they had the default password. Anybody could get into it and control it. So poorly protected IoT devices are easy to control. So that's what we are looking at. They're poorly protected. So the first part that, remember, there are three things I want you to remember once we are done with this is hijacking, right? Why does it happen? What does a hijacking look like? And how do we prevent it? So let's look at what does it look like? Let's look at some scenarios of how hijacked system can create havoc with people's lives. So one of them here, what you see is an insulin pump on an insulin on a diabetic patient, and he can be his electronic device, her electronic device can be vulnerable to hacking, and then some thief can take control and hold you at ransom. And what are you going to say if your life is on line? You would do anything. Or some other convict can control your pacemaker and hold you hostage. So your own devices inside your body can be used against you. There are infrastructure where there are a lot of compromises can hurt you. So let's see what hijacking looks like. So we have smart grids that runs the cities, and the security of the smart grid can be breached. What happens when that is done? So network grid controls traffic light, tall bridges. Any terrorist can get control of this and use cyber terrorism and hold the government hostage, because the whole infrastructure of the population depends on that until the demands are met. So it is really serious that we do something about it. This is what it looks like. I want to share another example. Energy is another sector. What happens when things in energy are compromised? So let's look at one thing. If we have smart meters and we use them to reduce our carbon footprint and to reduce our utility bills also, and they can be compromised. Someone can take control. And what happens? Let's look at this scenario. Grid can be manipulated, because it can be manipulated to send a lot of electricity to a certain area. Because data can be changed from smart grid to make it look like there is a high demand, and there may not be a high demand. But if it seems that there is a false demand, then there is a great supply, and the supply will cause a transformer to fail or a blackout will occur. And the panicked citizens will go to the ATMs or start hoarding supplies. And so cyber terrorists can take a nation hostage. So this is what happens. We talked about why, now we're talking about what happens. What bad things can happen. I want to take another case of transportation. I mean, this is really, scary. This can happen now. And sensors are used in railways a lot, because when two cars are coming, they make a decision to switch tracks, and two railways are coming, and if they are going to hit each other, there are sensors on the track that alert it. And when the personnel are alerted, then they will change course. And so if there was a compromised sensor, railroads will switch tracks. But compromised sensors will not alert, because they have been compromised. And therefore, the personnel will do nothing to override the switching. And the two cars will switch at the same time, two railroads, and cause a direct head-on collision. So that's really scary. How if transportation was compromised? There are other, so I say it is internet gone, internet of things gone broke. So they're supposed to be our slaves, our devices, but they serve an enemy. Other scenarios is espionage can happen, websites can be brought down by fake, getting them engaged in services so that they are not available for service to others. That's a denial of service. Personal system can result in fraud. Compromised machine can also degrade the performance of the machine that you're using. They can also, for example, if there is an essential sensor somewhere, they can create a lot of false traffic to the sensor and suck the battery dry. And so the sensor dies and it's a critical sensor. So, we talked about, first we looked at why do they get hijacked devices, then we talked about what happens. And now let's look at how can we prevent it. So that's a silver lining. We just need to act. We need to understand, we need to educate ourselves, and we need to act. An open group, is the forum, along with all other technology companies that can help fix it, and many others in that same ecosystem. So it is not that easy though. Before I start giving prescriptions and talk about recommendations, we have to understand what is the challenge. Why is it not so easy to secure things? First, there are so many devices, right? Machine to machine communication is going on. Each one has a different protocol. Energy has a different protocol. Health has a different protocol. Transportation has a different protocol. So because there is so much protocol proliferation, it's not easy to have regulation or standards. Not only that, not only are the protocols different, each protocol has a different way of initiating, starting the communication. So sometimes a listener starts a communication, sometimes some other person starts a communication. How can you build standards when the protocol and the way they are initiated are so different? The other problem is keys are hard-coded, and that makes it hard. How do you deal, how do you protect a hard-coded key? And the other one is the power is limited on these devices. What does it mean? Even if you put security policies, it's very hard to implement them. For example, your dishwasher is not going to have the resources to encrypt all the data that was ever sent to it. So there are, these are some of the problems where we are having an insecure Internet of Things. Then the patches are not managed. So Windows kind of takes over our system. It says, bye-bye, you're not going to use your computer for the next 3 hours. I'm going to update your system. There's nothing you can do about it. Nobody does it to the devices. Nobody's going to do it to my fridge. Also, this is a big one. You can't restart devices that control. So for example, if you loaded a patch on the computer and it restarts itself, then you're fine with it. You know, we are inconvenienced. But think about the fact. Suppose it is a power grid sensor or a controller that's controlling the whole of California's power. You can't reboot that. These are the devices that control a lot of things in health, infrastructure, so you cannot restart them. This is one of the challenges in securing Internet of Things. There is one more challenge, which is a big one, and that is the fact that they have binary code. Most of these IoTs have Linux on them, and they use Linux device driver, or some other open source components are there. So they don't have source code. They only have the binary. Because there is only binary code, how do you patch binary? Binary isn't easy to patch. And that is yet another reason why it is hard to have security standards for them. So we talked about the problems that, the challenges that are there. Now let's paint a scenario of how we want our future to look like with Internet of Things. So now we are the third part. We looked at why hijacking occurs. And then what does hijacking look like? We saw those scenarios. And now we're going to talk about how do we fix it? How do we prevent hijacking? So all these devices, first thing is that the connection to the internet should be need only. So most of them have a power on-off switch, but they don't have a wireless on-off switch. And that is one problem, because just because they're on, they don't have to be on the internet. So we need to put in control so that they're only on the internet when needed. we also should make sure it is behind a personal router. Because assuming the router is safe, which we found out wasn't always the case, right? And we should use firewall in our home environment always. So we put it near. And we should have critical security control for Internet of Things as well. The other thing is we have to design it right, and we have to design it right. That's very important. And virtualization is another way by which you can avert these problems. Because what does virtualization do? It limits the malicious activity, because it becomes a layer between you and the real system resources, and therefore your ability to change storage and networking configuration is very limited. And therefore, you can control the damage that is caused. There are many other ways we can secure gadgets. We should secure endpoints. That's extremely important. And how do we do that? Change the default password, first and foremost, because the default passwords are published on, you know, manufacturers have published them. We need to encrypt the password. Not only that, we should encrypt the storage of the personal information also. And we remove hard-coded password. Fingerprint readers would help. Fingerprinting is one thing, or any other kind of biometric like a retina. And then establish pins. And those are some of the ways by which we can secure our gadgets. There are some other ways to secure gadgets. We should make sure that authentication, authorization, and encryption is done. We do that for our normal computer system, so why should we not do it for our devices? The other thing is, rather than storing individual account information, we should use OAuth, simple device profile, or rather use OpenID Connect, because they have layers of authentication on top of it, rather than just storing the information. The other thing is that smart systems work by recognizing anomalies in a workflow. So when the smart system, if they're smart, then they have to heal themselves, they have to protect themselves. And so the smart systems know this is the normal workflow. And if they find that that normal workflow is interrupted, then they should send an alert. That is another way. The other way we do is that we have to have a seamless, strong authentication. Security is no good if it keeps getting in your way, right? And then risk analysis, also we correlate the past and the current. So banks, fraud system, that's how they work. They know this particular user always is in California. Suddenly if he shows up in London and spends $1 million, you know something is wrong. So those are some of the ways. You know, like any other security, when we talk security, we say it should be layered. And that's the simple advice, but very important. So what does that mean to have layers of security? Application and code should be secured. So that's multiple lines of defense. Network has to be secured. Infrastructure has to be secured. Endpoints have to be secured. Software has to be secured. Operating system has to be secured. And data has to be secured. Yes, it's a long list, but that's only way we can protect our devices. To be turned into robots. So this is how I want to talk about, from the power is turned on, how does a device go through different stages, and what kind of recommendations should be there, what kind of things should we do to ensure that hijacking, they're not hijacked. And first is, okay, you just powered it down, what should we do? At boot time, the authenticity and integrity of the software should be ensured. What does that mean? We must make sure, check that the cryptographically generated signals are used to authenticate, and make sure, how will this digital signature verification help? It will ensure that only that person who is authorized to run the device, only that software that is authorized, and the person who is authorized runs. So when it comes up, before you put software on it, we can make sure that only that software is used. For example, if a washing machine has a software which reads and sends data to a flight, or record something from a warehouse, you have to think something is wrong. And so if we limit the software that goes on it and limit the person who uses it, it goes a big way. So that's what we say, establish trust at the prototype. What is the next step? We have to have access control. Now we brought it up, we have to give it access control. So we must make sure that the least privileged access control is given. What does that mean? That the OS should limit the privileges that that particular device has. Just because it can do so many things, it should not have it. So if, depending on the role, depending on the function of the thing, we should give it only that much access and no more. That is extremely necessary to ensure that it doesn't have the software to do anything that it's not supposed designed to do. So now, okay, the power is the smart system was powered on. We put software on it. We define the access. What's the next step? Now it's going to send data. So we must authenticate before the data transfer is done. That means when it first tries to send it, it must authenticate itself. Machine authentication will allow the device to access the network based on username and password. And this credential should be stored in a secure area. And what is the next step after that? So assuming you had the system powered up, you did the digital signature. After that, you were able to limit its access, you were able to limit the software that gets loaded on it, and then you authenticated it. You're not done yet. Because even when it is doing data, you still have to do deep pocket inspection, and you have to firewall the device. Why do we have to do? Because any device that will terminate, any traffic that terminates at the device, should be inspected to see if it should be coming here. And if it is what it claims it is, what does that mean? In the internet protocol, there are many packets that are sent to the device which may have a hidden payload with a different agenda. So they look very harmless. So therefore it is not just okay to say, oh yeah, that guy is sending this and okay, everything's fine. You have to do a deep packet inspection. What does it mean? Open up the packet and see what the payload looks like. There is one thing that is very important here. As we do this filtering, as we do these tasks, we have to be mindful of the resources that the system has. If it consumes too much of bandwidth, and we have to be very mindful to design and use those security procedure which does not put it in jeopardy. So now, where are we? We powered the system, we authenticated it, we made sure that the data is fine, we opened up the packet, everything's good. No, not yet. We're not done yet. We have to do one more thing. And what is that? we have to make sure that it keeps getting patches because the world around us is changing. The signatures are changing, so we have to make sure it gets regular patches and updates. But that's not the story. The thing is, it should be able to do it while on flight. What does it mean? You can't reboot these control devices. So you should be able to update them while they are continuing to operate and to deliver the function that they're already doing. And so that's the key. So operators need to make sure that the patches are going out. They need to make sure devices are authenticated. They may want to make sure the bandwidth is not consumed, and we should make sure that the device doesn't fall down and the safety of people is not at risk. So the need for standards, right? So it's the standards that will help us. And why? Why do we need standards? We have to create the standards and we have to use them to build secure things. Building secure is much better than taking billions of devices and trying to fix them. You can't fix billions of devices, but we can design good things. How can we design good things unless we have the standards in place? That's why we in Open Group are putting our heads together to find this solution. So standards will also help ensure that manufacturer only runs those application-specific apps and accepts only the updates that come from the manufacturer. So only the manufacturer can make sure that the dishwasher takes only commands, updates from me and nobody else. He can make sure that he doesn't have any other apps. How will he do it? Unless there are regulations, standards. And also there's another thing that all the network providers, they will also make sure that they have standards, and they will make sure that only the packet, only the traffic that is allowed to come to the device will come to it. So a combination of these things will help us.